Well, my name's Steve Frissell, and I am the family ministry pastor here. It's great to be with you guys on 4th of July weekend. I've got a bucket list. How many of you guys got a bucket list? You know, the list of things that you hope to do before your day ends, right? On my bucket list is something that involves 4th of July. For a long time now, I've been thinking about this, and I want to start and do my own 4th of July parade. I would love to just be able to do that. Not a large parade, smaller parade, a parade that would probably happen, well, would happen on the sidewalk in front of the house of somebody from England. Probably get my kids and some other people that would join me, and we'll just make signs that say things like, "We won, you lost, how about them apples, take that, red coats." Well, I don't know all the signs yet, I'm still working on that, but I would just love to kind of start the day, you know, marching with some signs. Turns out Pete's from England. So tomorrow, I won't be at Pete's house. I found out he's a citizen here now, so it just didn't feel right. So, and I like my job. But if you want to join me and help me fulfill my bucket list, you can let me know if you know a good Brit that we could go and visit. That would be great. I said that last service, and a guy caught me in the crossing and said, "Hey, my parents are from England, and they do a 3rd of July party because it's the last day they had control. So if you want to rub it in their face," I'm like, awesome. That's the kind of person I want to do that to. So they'll think it's fun. So anyway. We are in this series, Paul Speaks, and we are looking at Paul, who really is, I mean, come on, think about it. In all of history, he is one of the most interesting men that has ever lived. And so we're taking the next few weeks, and really actually the whole summer, and we're looking at what did God have to say through Paul to us, and specifically to some different churches. So last week, Steve taught, and he taught out of Romans, and we got to kind of see what God had to say through Paul to the church in Rome and to us as well. And we're going to continue in that as we go through different letters that he wrote. And just so you guys know, here's our hope and our heart's desire for you as our church. Pete just did an incredible series on how to study the Bible. And he spent a long time really coming around the three big things that you do when you interact with the Spirit as you go through Scripture. And it's observation, interpretation, and application. And so he did a great job of teaching us practically how to do that, how to walk through Scripture and interact with the Spirit. And our hope is now that as we kind of take this summer, we're walking through whole books of the Bible each week, kind of setting up the theme for you. And now you can take, I'm on Ephesians this morning, you can take this week, read through the 6 chapters of Ephesians, and put into practice what Pete taught and how to study the Bible. And so spend some time doing the observation, interpretation, and application as you can go through. This is a great one that you can do it with because there's 6 chapters, and just do a chapter a day and you can walk through Ephesians and put that into practice. Now, Ephesians is a little bit different than some of the other letters that Paul wrote. Ephesians kind of has a lot of the personal, like, kind of things where he called a church out on something are kind of missing from Ephesians. He doesn't really condemn the church for specific issues that they're wrestling with. And there's some theories as to why Ephesians is like that. One of them is that Ephesians was a letter written, just a vague letter written to any church, really, and you could just change in the heading who the to is from. It's kind of like writing a love letter to, you know, just a general love letter and just putting the person's name at the top, whoever you end up falling in love with, right? So there's different ideas and theories as to why the letter is written the way it was. Paul did spend 3 years in Ephesus, and so he knew the people there well, knew that church well, and for whatever reason, this letter doesn't have those things in it. But what is similar to this letter with some of the others is he opens up and spends the front part just really doing a lot of teaching a lot of truth and a lot of theology. And then the second part of the book is really a lot of application. So as you take some time this week and read in Ephesians, the first 3 chapters is full of truth. Lots of observation and lots of interpretation. And then the second 3 chapters is all about application. He talks about how to live out that truth. And so in Ephesians, we get to see how he talks practically about what does it really look like to really use the gifting that God has given us, serve in the church, be the body of Christ, change the world, and make a difference for the kingdom. Talks a lot about how we can really have victory over temptation and not fall into the desires of the flesh. but live by the Spirit and live in light. Talked practically of what it means to really have a God-honoring marriage. Husbands, how you can love your wife as Christ loved the church and die to yourself every day. Wives, you can give your husband unconditional respect. Kids in the room, there's a challenge to you to obey your parents. Talks about how we can go into spiritual warfare with the full armor. So that's the heart of Ephesians. Now, as Paul writes this, there's this underlying theme where he talks about these mysteries, and there's these mysteries to be revealed. And so for thousands of years and for generations, there's been these things that have been secret until now, until Christ came. And so he kind of unpacks some mysteries. He talks about it. You can follow along. The verses will be up on the screens for you because we're going to flip through a bunch of these pretty quick. Ephesians 1:9, he says, God has now revealed to us his mysterious plan regarding Christ, a plan to fulfill his own good pleasure. Ephesians 3:3-4. As I briefly wrote earlier, God himself revealed his mysterious plan to me. As you read what I've written, you'll understand my insight into this plan regarding Christ. Ephesians 3:9. I was chosen to explain to everyone this mysterious plan that God, the creator of all things, had kept secret from the beginning. There's this mystery that nobody knew for so long. Ephesians 5:32, this is a great mystery, but is an illustration of the way Christ and the church are one. He closes out his letter and says, and pray for me too. Ask God to give me the right words so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan that the good news is for the Jews and Gentiles alike. Paul's writing is talking about how there's these mysteries, these things we didn't know. When I was younger, and I still do like to play them, but I don't as often now, but when I was younger, I loved playing board games. For you kids in the room, a board game is a game that you play that doesn't involve a remote or a controller. There's not a sensor screen that picks up your movements. This isn't involving a TV or touch screen of any kind. You're not slicing fruit like a ninja. This is a game where you physically either roll dice or spin a spinner, and there's pieces that you move across a board. I like playing some different board games when I was younger. One of them was Risk. Anybody remember this? Some of you? Yeah. This usually involved me and my friends. By the end, we'd get bored, and by the end, we'd flip the furniture over, and we're just throwing the pieces at each other, doing our own. Or Love Monopoly. Love that one. Always went with the railroads. That's always safe. One of the games I really loved, though, was Clue. You remember Clue? Yeah, some Clue pride. There we go. Awesome. Clue. This is where you're trying to solve a mystery. You're trying to figure out who did it. And there was this really neat thing about playing this game because you didn't know, and so you're in the process of trying to figure out, and then all of a sudden you get to the end, you're like, ah, it was Colonel Mustard in the library with the candlestick. What's up? And you get all excited because you figured it out. It's exciting. There's the mystery, the aha moment. You solved it. I love watching shows that have that mystery thing to it too, right? Where you're trying to figure out who did it. And, you know, so those criminal ones, it's always kind of cool. You're trying to figure out, okay, who was it? Who really did it? And you have your own theory going all along the way. Then there's shows like Lost that just have tons of mystery. I still have no idea what the polar bear was on the tropical island. If you watched Lost, maybe you can fill me in on that later. One of the things I really love, though, is when you watch a show or a movie that has a twist at the end and you didn't even realize there was this mystery all along the way, and then all of a sudden it's like, ba-da! And you're like, whoa, what happened? Kind of like, if you haven't, I'm going to ruin a movie for you, but it's a really old movie, so if you haven't seen it, this is like, you can't get mad at me. Don't send me a hate email, please. Sixth Sense, all right? This is an old one. So if you haven't seen it yet and you're still hanging on to hear it, like watch it at some point, just plug your ears. In this movie, there's this kid. If you've seen it, you'll remember. Maybe you haven't seen it, but you will remember this line from it that was like famous for a little while, where the little kid's like, I see dead people, right? It's this little kid. He can see dead people. Really creepy, right? It's kind of a freaky movie, but he's interacting with these dead people, and then eventually he sees this counselor who's working with him through it and kind of helping him out, and that's played by Bruce Willis. all of a sudden, bombshell, end of the movie, you find out Bruce Willis was dead. You had no clue the whole movie. He didn't even know it. He figures out and you're like, what just happened, right? You're amazed. And then like you walk away and you're like, you want to tell everybody about it, but you don't want to ruin the movie and be that jerk, right? So, but there's this really neat thing when there's this mystery all along, you didn't know about it, and all of a sudden, boom, mystery solved. All of a sudden, like, this crazy thing happens, and you have this new understanding. Kind of like this aha moment where it's just like, whoa, and it makes sense. It's pretty cool. Well, Paul's writing this letter, and he's saying to all these people, hey, just so you know, there's been a mystery, a few of them. Things you had no idea. For thousands of generations, people had no clue. And now, what's kind of neat is after Christ resurrected, and as the disciples and different people interacted with him, all of a sudden there's all these aha moments where they're going, oh my gosh, we had no idea. That was God's plan all along the way. Paul writes this letter, and he reveals a handful of different mysteries. One of the big ones is that the church is from Jew and Gentile. So whether you were distant and far off and thought you could never be right with this God, you can be. And one of the truths, one of the mysteries that Paul reveals in here is this mystery that when you understand this and the implications of it and what it is, it leaves you with the opportunity, the potential for you to live your life completely different, a radically different life. So what happened for Paul and so many other people is for the first time they began to experience life. And he reveals this mystery so so many others can too. This week, I'd encourage you as you're reading through, take some time and really camp in Ephesians chapter 2. That's what we're going to be talking through today. In verses 1 through 10, Paul kind of unpacks a mystery and describes us. We're not going to walk through it verse by verse. Just want to kind of explain it to you a little bit and kind of an illustration that I found that helps us understand it. But in Ephesians 2, chapter 1, it starts talking about who we were before Christ and who people were for thousands of generations and you and I before Christ comes and dwells in us, who we were. And it talks about us and says we were dead. We were spiritually dead, deserving of the wrath of God, obedient to Satan. That's a kind of life, that's a life that has little hope, no peace. That's a life where we're overwhelmed with guilt and shame. And that's who we were. And it says, but God, who is rich in mercy, did for us what we could never ever do on our own. And talks about how he came and brings us life, even though we were dead. And it talks about in verses 8 and 9 how it's not something that you earned, it's not something you worked for, it's not anything that you were good enough for. It was completely done by Christ, and we just simply put our faith in that. And then he kind of wraps up this thought with Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. You can follow along with me here. It says, for we are God's masterpiece. Hey, kids in the room, you know when you get to draw a picture or you make some sort of a craft, and it's just the way you liked it, and you're proud of it, right? When you're all done, you're like, yeah, this is exactly what I wanted it to be. You're proud. And sometimes an artist will sign their name on it. What Paul's saying is you are a masterpiece. Your creator is proud. It's like he signed his name, saying this is exactly what I wanted you to be. It says, we are God's masterpiece, and he has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. I hope this helps for you kids in the room. Here's an illustration that I found that will help us understand these verses. This is you. So for the sake of this illustration, pretend this is you and all the quirky things that make you you. So maybe you love chocolate candy over sour candy, and everybody that thinks sour candy is the bomb, you think they're crazy. All right? Or maybe you are the kind of guy who will go through the painstaking process of cutting your yard, not in the vertical or horizontal, but you go with the diagonal pattern so that when it's all said and done, you can go, that's a good looking yard. And you hope your neighbors are jealous. Maybe this is you and you are like me and you don't like your food touching on your plate. And, thank you. And you eat your food one at a time in order from what you like least to what you like most. Yes. There's a few of you out there, good. You're like me. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not weird. Maybe you love to read. Maybe you enjoy walks. Whatever it is about you that makes you you. Maybe you're the kind of you that just notices people's feet all the time. And you could identify people based off a lineup of feet because you notice the moles that they have on their toes or whatever it is about you that makes you you. This is you. Now, what this passage talks about is the bummer is when you came into the world, there was an issue. You had something in you, and that was sin. You had sin in you, okay? Scripture talks about this. This comes from us being from Adam and Eve, right? Because Adam and Eve have sinned, all have sinned. And the bummer is we got sin in us, and not only do we have sin in us, we are also in sin. All right? So this is how we come into this world, with sin in you and you in sin. And this is a bad place. This is not a fun place to be. This is a place that has a whole lot of religion, a whole lot of trying, a whole lot of hoping that you measure up. There's a lot of guilt and a lot of shame. There's no hope. No peace. And you can't do anything about this. You can't fight your way out. You can't be good enough to get out. This is how we were. And the good news is that Christ didn't leave us here. He gives us an opportunity. So, what Christ did for us on the cross can rescue us, so no longer do we have this in us, adios, and no longer you have to deal with sin in you. Ready? Here we go. Awesome. So, God takes care of it, you get out of there, and the good news is you're not just left like this, He replaces it. You get something inside of you. You get Christ in you. Now, if you don't understand how big of a deal this is huge. You have the Spirit of God, the creator of the universe, residing in you. Amen, amen, yes. And it doesn't stop there. The good news is you are in Christ. Yeah, pretty awesome, right? So, you no longer are dealing with being in sin and sin in you. Now you have Christ in you, and Scripture talks about how you are in Christ. And Scripture is very clear that this is a place full of freedom. And did you know that Christ is in the Father? Did you know that? That Christ is in the Father. And so since Christ is in the Father, we're not done. We got the big daddy. Here he is. You are also and the Father. Yeah, that's worthy of a woo. Amen, that's right. This is you. And still all the weird stuff about you. You still don't like your food to touch on the plate. That didn't change. You don't mix it all up now. You're still you. How God sees you has changed. I mean, look, do you see you in there? Here's the Father, there's Christ, there's you. See, there's you. If
you look real, real close, you can see Christ kind of in there too, inside of you. What's fascinating and incredible is when God sees you, and when he looks at you, he mainly sees himself. He sees you in him as a righteousness of him. And you're still goofy. But you're in him, and you've been made right with God. And this is a life of freedom, of hope, a life of peace, a life free from guilt and shame. And this is what we've been invited to. Scripture talks about this life that we have in Christ. Let me just read you a few of the things of what Scripture says about this life. In Christ, you are loved by God. In Christ, you are completely forgiven. In Christ, you have the life of Christ. In Christ, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing. In Christ, you've been chosen by God. In Christ, you have died to sin's power. In Christ, you have been delivered from darkness and transferred into light. It's what we sang about. In Christ, you've been raised up and you are sitting with God in heaven. Think about that. You are sitting in not the cheap seats, the nice seats in the heavenly realms. Not obstructed view. In Christ, you have been made complete. In Christ, you have the hope of glory. In Christ, you have the mind of Christ. In Christ, you have been established. You have access to his power. In Christ, you have been freed forever. In Christ, you are the child of God. And in Christ, you are the righteousness of God. Amen. Amen. Here's what I'd love for you to do. If you agree with me, raise your hand. How many of you believe that God is a good God and his plans for you are what's best? Good. How many of you feel like God is doing great things through you? Awesome. How many of you believe that God is a God of love? How many of you feel like God loves you? How many of you believe that Christ's death washed you clean from sin? How many of you feel completely holy sitting in your seats right now? A lot less hands. Like 10. How many of you believe that Christ rose from the grave and is victorious? How many of you feel like you can live in victory every moment of every day? Good. See, we know that this is true. We know that God has forgiven us, but we don't always feel forgiven. Right? I mean, there's this point when we trusted him, but yet still sometimes it seems like we still need this mystery to be revealed, and we have the true aha moment. Wow, I am holy, and that's how God sees me. Most of us don't feel holy right now, do we? Because we still sin. The problem that we make and the mistake that we make is we allow how we feel to change what we believe about God and what we believe to be true. And this morning, we needed to have that mystery revealed in the aha moment where we know and understand fully, this is how my God sees me. And this is true. And because of this, we now have the opportunity and the freedom to live a marvelous life, a wonderful life, and do miraculous things. God has redeemed us to him so that we can truly just experience intimacy with him. And out of that, the overflow is we live a life of freedom. Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's masterpiece, created anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. This is true. This is who we are. And when God looks at us, he mainly sees himself. And this is how we can live in freedom, free of guilt, free of shame. Here's what I would love for you to do this week, because I think a lot of us still need this to land in our hearts even more, right? I mean, it's easy for us just to forget this. It's easy for us to go home and mess up and sin or whatever. And so what we want to do is we want to let this kind of land in our hearts a little bit more. So take Ephesians chapters 1 and 2. This is your application this week. Take Ephesians chapter 1 and 2. Print it out off of a Bible gateway, or you can do this in your own Bible if you want. But I want you to go through those two chapters and find the words that describe you. Circle them, underline them, highlight them, do whatever it is. There's a whole list of them, a bunch of words that describe you. And then I want you to take the one. There's one that's going to resonate with you the most. There's one that the Spirit really just wants to speak into you about you being this. And I want you to sit down and have a conversation with somebody else about it. This is a conversation you have with somebody in your life group, maybe somebody you work with. This is a conversation at my house that we're going to have around the dinner table this week, where I'm going to sit down, my wife and my kids, and we're all just going to share what's the one that God really said to us that resonated with us. Here's Ephesians chapters 1, verses 3 and 4, just to kind of give you an idea of what I'm talking about. All praise to God, the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms, because we are united with Christ. Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. Five words that describe us there is we are blessed, we are united, we are loved, we are chosen, and we are holy. Take the rest of Ephesians chapters 1 and 2 and find these words that describe you and let the Spirit speak into you, one of them where he says, that's how I see you and that's who you are. Some beautiful words in there about being redeemed and purchased, adopted. Let the Spirit speak to you. And as you study the rest of Ephesians, allow this to be the thing to inspire you. Because imagine what it would be like for you this week to be able to understand and embrace the fact that as a husband, I can love my wife as Christ loved the church because I have the Spirit in me giving me the strength and the will to be obedient. I can die to myself because this is how God sees me and this is truly who I am. Wives, you can respect your husband even the moments when he deserves it the least because you've been called to an unconditional respect that doesn't matter if he deserves it or not. And as Christ in you gives you the will to be obedient to him, you can honor your husbands. Kids, you can obey your parents even when it doesn't make any sense when they ask you to do the things they ask you to do, but you can do it because Christ is in you. You can have victory over temptation because this is who you are. Take this week, experience life, the life of Christ in you, and understand that he has redeemed you to himself. And know that this Christian life isn't about trying harder. It's about dying to yourself and just allowing the Spirit and Christ to live in and through you. If you have never trusted Christ and you kind of recognize now this morning that you have sin in you and you are in sin, you have not put your faith in this and understood that this is how God sees you, here's what I want to encourage you to do. Take some time this morning and just say, God, change me to that. Make me like you. I don't want to deal with the guilt and the shame any longer. Kids, if you're in the room and this helped all of this make a little bit more sense for you, here's what I'd love for you to do, guys. Take a moment and just pray. Pray a prayer like, God, change me. Come into my life. And while you pray that prayer, kids, here's what I'd love for you to do. Reach over. If this is the first time you're praying this, reach over and hold your mom or your dad's hand as you pray it. And parents, you pray for your kids while they pray it. Let's take a moment. Let's bow our heads and let's pause. If you want to trust Christ this morning, here's what I encourage you to pray. God, change me. God, I can't do it on my own. I need you to change me. Make me like you. Come into my life. Help me to draw close to you. Help me to know what it means to walk with you. Help me learn what it means to live and experience life. God, I pray that this morning will be an aha moment for a lot of us. As what maybe really shouldn't have been a mystery, but is a mystery, has been revealed. And that we are holy. And that we allow our feelings to cloud our judgment. And we have the opportunity to live in victory. Because you are victorious and you live in and through us. God, we love you. We lift you up. And we thank you for doing what we could never, ever do for ourselves.